The aim of this lesson will be to briefly sketch the philosophical backdrop of the modern period. In examining contemporary theology, one realizes that much of contemporary theology has appropriated various ideas and methods from modern philosophy and conjoined them to biblical language and concepts. Hence, in order to understand the contemporary era of theology, it is imperative that we gain a handle on the philosophy that underlies the modern period. To do that, however, we must first look at the medieval relationship between philosophy and theology. In the medieval period, and stretching back in some degree to the ancient period, all philosophers were by definition theologians, and all theologians were by definition philosophers. The medieval period regarded theology as the queen of the sciences, such that one studied the fields of logic, mathematics, language, literature, and philosophy as the indispensable preliminaries for studying and laboring in the most important field, namely theology. Conversely, perceiving theology as the queen of the sciences meant that all other disciplines must, in some fashion, be related to theology. Thus, medieval philosophers, while treating many of the same broad topics as treated in modern philosophy, like metaphysics, epistemology, and ethics, medieval philosophers would view these topics through the presuppositional lens of God's existence and ultimate significance as the summum bonum, or highest good. In short, God was the starting point of medieval philosophy, and all philosophical work saw God playing a significant role. The French philosopher and mathematician René Descartes, who lived from 1596 to 1650, however, championed a new way of doing philosophy based upon a radically different epistemology. He held that the proper starting point for philosophical reflection was not God, but rather that which the human mind could know beyond any doubt. Hence his 1641 Meditations on First Philosophy commences by calling into question everything he thought he knew to test whether he, in fact, actually knew it. Systematically questioning one element after another which he formerly held as knowledge, Descartes found reasonable doubt that he really knew these elements. Even for elements which seem certain, such as the existence of the external world, Descartes concluded that they were doubtable, since it was logically possible for there to be an evil demon who was tampering with his sensory perceptors. As a result of this method, Descartes arrived at one certain truth, which he said must serve as the starting point of philosophy. This one certain truth turned out to be his own existence, summed up in the Latin phrase, cogito ergo sum. I think, or I doubt, therefore I am. For Descartes found that even when he doubted his own existence, there was someone, he himself, who did the doubting, thus proving his existence absolutely. This certain truth, often styled the cogito, gained almost unanimous assent in the subsequent history of philosophy as its new epistemological starting point. Hence, the starting point of philosophy was no longer God, but rather one's own consciousness, the certainty of oneself as a thinking being. Descartes spearheaded the movement known as rationalism. Rationalism is a theory of philosophy in which the criterion of truth is primarily intellectual and deductive. Frequently appealing to the law of non-contradiction, which means that a statement cannot be both true and false at the same time and in the same sense, rationalism introduced mathematical models into philosophy. Rationalists often maintain that the non-contradictory character of a possible entity was sufficient to guarantee its actual existence. For instance, if no contradiction was to be found in the notion of humans having an immortal soul, then humans must have an immortal soul. In contrast to rationalism, the movement of empiricism maintained sensory experience as its criterion of truth, postulating that nothing is in the mind which is not first in the senses. Empiricists argued that sensory experience was the sole source of knowledge, such that knowledge could only be acquired via sensory contact with the external world. Combining the opposing traditions of rationalism and empiricism was the epical German philosopher Immanuel Kant, who lived from 1724 to 1804. Before the time of Kant, philosophers viewed the mind as quite passive in its acquisition of knowledge, whereby data would inundate the senses and imprint themselves upon the mind as though it were a blank slate. Kant asserted that such a view proved fundamentally inaccurate, as the mind interacted with the world logically prior to the world's impacting the mind. Kant postulated that there are certain basic concepts inherent in the mind that allow the mind to interact with the world and to make judgments about what is and is not actually occurring in the world. One such concept is causality. While humans do not actually see causal connections in the world, they frequently see one event occur and then another event occur and conclude, based on the idea of causation intrinsic to the mind, that the first event caused the second event. This, along with other mentally intrinsic categories like disjunction, or perceiving various things as alternatives, particularity and universality, allow us to understand and evaluate reality. Kant termed these categories transcendental because, although they are located in experience as an interconnected whole, they transcend and are separate from the sensuous materials found in the world. Hence, Kant's system is a priori, or given, in that the categories logically precede the materials which they relate. Kant's change in the understanding of the knowing relation and the understanding of how the mind functions in knowing was so monumental that it is recognized as his Copernican revolution in philosophy. Just as Copernicus made the pivotal cosmological shift from Ptolemaically viewing the Earth as the center of the galaxy to heliocentrically viewing the sun as the center of the galaxy, so Kant's epistemology made the pivotal philosophical shift from viewing the mind as passive to viewing the mind and the world as synergistically involved in the knowing process. Kant's Copernican revolution in philosophy had profound repercussions for the theory of sense perception. Kant reasoned that if the mind is as active and significant in the gaining of knowledge as the data of sense, distortion of reality may occur not only through the sensory organs, but also through the mind itself. Consequently, Kant insisted that for any given thing, we must distinguish between the thing in itself and the thing for us, or as it appears to us, due to possible distortion by the sensory organs and the mind alike. No one is ever in a position to see anything in itself, but may only see a thing as it appears to the observer. Accordingly, if one's mind possesses the concept of a cat, but lacks the concept of a dog, and one sees a dog, one may well misidentify the dog as a large cat. The Kantian view of perception generated an increasing philosophical consensus that humans lack the ability to have direct and immediate contact with the external world, Rather, they only possess the ability to have direct and immediate contact with the basic thoughts and ideas in their own consciousness. We shift at this point to the field of metaphysics, which deals with the nature and structure of reality. This field encountered far more radical change from the time of Descartes to Kant than did epistemology. Exhibiting a far more negative assessment than any of his precursors, Kant boldly asserted that he put an end to metaphysics altogether. For Kant insisted that there are a number of things, including God, the soul, immortality, and the world as a whole, which lay utterly beyond our experience. These things transcend our experience and are not things for us at all. For Kant deemed that in no wise can the mind apply the categories of thought to a non-sensuous thing. All of the objects not available to us via the senses, Kant placed in the noumenal realm. Kant then contended that anything in the noumenal realm is ipso facto not an object of knowledge. Thus, with Kant, the notion of metaphysics turns full circle, as God goes from being the starting point of philosophy and the foundation of knowledge in medieval thought to no longer being considered even an object of knowledge. So according to Kant, things like God, the immortal soul, and the world in its entirety are not objects of knowledge. For Kant, positing in a rationalist vein that we do know some such things because their concepts are not self-contradictory is insufficient. This does not mean that such entities as God, the immortal soul, and the world in its entirety do not exist, but it does mean that even if they do exist, there is no way to prove that they exist. While Kant did believe in the existence of God, he averred that God must be a postulate of practical reason, not pure reason. For if there were no God, then we could not ensure the moral governance of the world. Kant believed that religion had one main purpose, to furnish moral foundations and education for society. In his most significant book on religion, Religion Within the Limits of Reason Alone, Kant relegated religion to the ethical realm. Authentic religion, including true Christianity, amounted to living a life in harmony with rationally discernible duty. Given the indispensability of genuine moral accountability in the universe, Kant claimed that there had to be a God, but we cannot prove that there is one, since God lies beyond the realm of what we can know. As a result, God is effectively taken out of metaphysics and thus debarred from demonstration, knowability, and meaningful discourse. Ironically, Kant viewed this as a major step forward for Christianity. He wrote concerning God, quote, "I have therefore found it necessary to deny knowledge in order to make room for faith," end quote. So although Christians can never know God and other realities beyond the human senses, they can still believe in them. Hence, Kant instigated the infamous distinction between knowledge and faith. This lesson has presented some of the key concepts that form the background of modern theology and philosophy. The major Enlightenment developments occurring from Descartes to Kant form the thematic springboard for the work of several contemporary theologians and philosophers discussed in this course, who were spurred to react to these developments in both positive and negative ways.